Hi, this is Shannon Steimel, and I am happy to welcome Michelle Benedict here for
good morning
for my Gratitude 180 project, where I am sharing the educators and people in who have influenced my thinking in education. I will let Michelle introduce herself in just a minute, but I just want to give a little bit of background about how I became familiar with her. So there is a conference every summer called STL and STL that brings in great like national speakers as well as local ones. And Michelle did a presentation on empowering learners through self-regulation. And it was the best, by far, the best session that I went to of that conference. And it really got me thinking. And in fact, I came back to my school saying, okay, we've got to get Michelle here. We've got to get our kids breathing. You know, let's do something about this. And so I was really happy when our director decided to bring her in for some PD on educator self-care that kind of incorporates this idea of mindfulness as well. So when I first met Michelle, she was an elementary school teacher, but she's actually transitioned a little bit. So I'm going to let her introduce herself and tell a little bit about her journey and her organization she's working for now. If I can find my mouse, which seems to have disappeared. There we go. All right, Michelle, take it away.
Sure. My name's Michelle Benedict, and I am the managing director of Be Mindful. And Be Mindful is a nonprofit that's actually based in Denver, but we work nationwide to engage people and inspire people in mindful living. So and basically, we just want every human to be self-regulated. So that's our mission. And we especially work with populations of people who are not normally served. So we have a really special model with our programming. So every program that we sell to, for example, like the school that we came to, I came to your school. Whenever you buy a program, then we give a program away for free to a different organization. So in this particular instance, whenever Live for Life had us come in, then we started working at St. Martha's Hall, which is a domestic violence shelter in downtown. So all the money goes to something to help another person learn how to be self-regulated. So I just love what I do because we help people that can afford to be helped, and then we use that money to help people who can't.
Oh, Michelle, that is wonderful to hear. That's just great. Will you tell just a little bit of your background as well? Because one of the things I really appreciated about your presentation is it gave a lot of practical tips, and I could tell that you had lived this in the classroom.
Yep. Well, a few years ago, I transitioned from special ed to regular ed. And special ed, I was leaving because I felt the environment of special ed was overwhelming with the caseloads and the paperwork and whatnot. So I thought, oh, okay, well, it'll be easier to be a general ed teacher. I thought that was a really good idea. But I also moved from a school that was a very engaged parent-wise school. So a lot of high parent engagement, higher socioeconomic backgrounds of parents, you know, so the kids were doing well. And I moved to Hazelwood, where that is not always the case. So the school that I moved into, we were one of the schools that don't meet Title I criteria, so we don't get the extra funding, but we're right on the line. So you just don't get anything. And that's what's really hard. So a lot of our kids were underserved. A lot of our kids have a lot of poverty issues, a lot of trauma, which was the opposite of the classroom that I had worked in previously. So I felt like about 75 to 80% of my kids were fairly compliant at the previous school that I worked at. And then I got to my new school and it was the opposite. So I moved into a classroom of 18 kids and 11 of those kids were on a tier 3 behavior plan. And so that's not what I was expecting. I've been from a special ed class to an intensive special ed class. Except I wasn't doing IEPs. I was doing interventions, but it was basically the same kind of work. The other thing that I found is that a lot of the kids just had an enormous amount of trauma. We just had a lot of kids who were, families were experiencing high amounts of problems, money issues, all kinds of things. And that was, I moved into Hazelwood the year after we had the Ferguson issue. So there was a lot of families who moved from that to that, from that community to ours. So I think there was just a lot of hurt and a lot of pain. So whenever I moved in, I couldn't get kids to learn. They weren't learning. I spent tons of time teaching. I would reteach. I did all the strategies that I knew of, and nothing was sticking. That same year, my mom passed away. That same year, my son, his appendix burst, and I thought I was going to lose my mind, and I was ready to leave teaching. And this was only my fourth year of teaching. And then I didn't want to be a statistic because I had a passion and heart for the work. The kids, they love me because I was one of those kids that was the hard kid whenever I was younger. So I can usually meet them where they are. But I still, with all my skills, could not reach so many of the kids in my classroom. So I just, I felt defeated. At the same time, I was taking a graduate class at Lindenwood, and my professor at the time, Dr. Emily Johnson, she offered up. She's like, Michelle, I know you. Why don't you do a project on your own this semester and find something that you're really interested in? Because I know you're really working at this new job and trying to make this work. So I did a ton of research trying to figure out what will help my kids remember better, what will help them learn better. And mindfulness just kept coming up. And I was like, what is mindfulness? And so I started practicing on my own. And I was like, wow, this is pretty cool. But I didn't know how things would go at school. I didn't know how parents would feel. I didn't know how my administration would feel, because this is not something that you heard about in St. Louis at the time, especially several years ago. So,
One of the things that you said in your presentation at SDL and SDL was, would you rather spend 5 minutes at the beginning of class breathing or 35 minutes chasing behaviors?
Exactly. And that's like what that I found. Yes, because that's what I spent the entire day chasing behavior, and I didn't get any learning done. And that I just felt, like I said, defeated at the end of every single day. Now, I don't feel like that particular class got the benefit of what I was able to offer, because I started in that room in October. So I was already behind the eight ball on that. But there were some kids who learned some stuff, I would say. The next year I started on day one. And that was where the game changer came in. Like, we started, the kids didn't have any idea why we were doing breathing practices, because I didn't start teaching them about the brain for a couple of weeks. But it just became like, this is what we do. So I got out my singing bowl, which the kids had never seen before, because this was a novel thing. And I got that idea from Heather Forbes, who that's some of the trainings that I've been to is her training. And now I speak at her conferences, which makes me feel, I don't know, really cool. But she was one of my mentors and definitely somebody I admire. But but it was amazing. Like, it took, 4 to 6 weeks, like every intervention. But at about the 6 week point, kids just started asking for the bowl whenever we needed to be self-regulated. They started understanding about their brain and started taking breaks preemptively if they needed to. The calmness in the classroom was there. And people just started coming into my classroom at random times, like on their plan time, just to sit in my classroom because it was so calm and it was relaxing and nice. We always had music going on, and I don't know, it was just a place that people wanted to be. And I love that. Kids used to come have lunch with me from other grade levels. And I just felt like, even though certain kids weren't in my classroom, they were still benefiting from the vibe in my room. And adults too. So I just think, was totally a game changer. Now, the best part is I spent this whole year teaching kids about the brain, about doing this breathing, and everybody thought I wasted my time. They're like, she's wasted her whole year teaching kids how to be calm and whatnot. And so they're not going to do well on the standardized test. So when MAP testing came, we did all the things that I taught the kids to do about being regulated. I saw them doing it during the test, which was so awesome. And then, we have to wait months for those results. But when the results came, I was 40% higher than everyone else.
Wow, that's amazing.
I believe in this practice. And then I repeated it 3 more years. So that's the thing. It's like, it would be different if I hadn't done, you know, if I did it just once. But my results are repeatable across the country with in classrooms all over the place that where people are using this as a strategy, not just to help kids learn, but a strategy to help kids live and thrive. And that's a life skill. Because we certainly see a ton of adults who are, you know, dysregulated walking around the planet, and we sure would like them to take a deep breath once in a while.
Yeah. So Michelle, I know, you know, you could spend hours on this topic, and, you know, there's a lot of science behind it. But if you were kind of to just give us the quick and dirty version of, of what we would need to know to kind of help us understand and get started with mindfulness.
Sure. So in, so mindfulness is the deliberate use of attention focused on your current experience without getting caught in your internal chatter or emotions. So that's the definition that Be Mindful sits by. And there's a lot of different definitions, but it's mostly about that intentional use of focus, intentional use of focus on right now, because most of the time we have what we're feeling and what's happening in our senses at the time, but we also have internal chatter that also helps us make sense of our experience. So when we get triggered, what happens in our brain is that, well, if it's a positive experience, it takes about half a millisecond for our brain to say, oh, okay, this is okay. Everything's fine. You get information through your thalamus, your amygdala then is your fight, flight, or freeze processor. So it decides, hey, is something wrong or is something not wrong? So if it's positive, it gets that information, says, in, like I said, in about a half a second, that everything's fine, and you're able to use your hippocampus, which is your memory center, and your prefrontal cortex, which is the processing part of your brain where all the academics and language and everything happens in your brain. Those parts stay on, stay active during positive experiences. The problem is anytime you have a negative experience, or even a perceived negative experience, doesn't have to be a real one. For kids, it could be something that feels a little wrong or a little off. It's same with adults, but especially in the classroom and thinking about the classroom, you hand them a piece of paper or you give them a Google, you know, classroom assignment, and they get on and they don't understand the directions. That would immediately trigger a kid, whether it's not a life or death situation, but it doesn't matter to your brain. Your brain is like a one or zero, like a computer. So when it's one, it's like, whoa, I'm on, or it's a zero and it's off. So during those negative experiences, the thalamus, you know, brings them that same information. And then the amygdala says, wait, this is not cool. I'm not okay. And so then it shuts down your memory center, shuts down the processing and academic process, you know, all that academic stuff, all shut down. And they are immediately triggered, and they cannot, they can't do what you want them to do at that point. There's no possible way for them to do it, because the smart part of their brain, the part of their brain that is going to do anything on that worksheet or assignment is off, because your body, when you're in that state, its job is to keep you alive. And it doesn't know the difference between, like I said, that perceived bear coming at you or you being in life or death, or a child sitting there who's doesn't understand the directions and feels lost. It's just as triggering in your brain. So, and that happens, and the negative response happens even faster than the positive response. We tend to go negative first out of that survival need. So,
you know, and teachers who don't understand this are often escalating the situation with a kid who is triggered, and instead of de-escalating it, you know, we want compliance, we want them to, you
respect
and all that. And, you know, if your amygdala has hijacked the part of your brain that can talk about things and what's going on.
That's that's the biggest point that I like to tell people, and that's why I keep reminding people that that's where language comes from. Your prefrontal cortex is where your language processing comes from, so you are never going to have a good conversation with any person that's triggered, ever. It won't be productive, because they can't feel empathy in the same way. They can't have the same judgment. They can't have long-term consequences. They don't understand sequence. And I know people are like, well, that's coddling people. No. You just have to de-escalate them, and then you can go right back to having that conversation. But if you have someone who's triggered, there's really no point in continuing a conversation until they're down.
You know, and so the idea that mindfulness, you know, is kind of the stop in between that stimulus and response, right. I think is a really powerful one. And I love too that, you know, you didn't just understand the science yourself, like you taught the brain science to the kids as well so that they could understand it, you know, and hearing elementary kids talk about their amygdala is really cute.
It is really cute. And it's super powerful because you think about all the time that we've spent learning about different parts of our body, and the brain controls it all. And it's the least amount, like it's the organ that we spend least amount of time on when we learn about body systems. And it literally is the most important because nothing happens without it. So I felt like whenever I was spending that time teaching kids about the brain, they understood then the why they needed to do it. It wasn't about, I didn't have to do anything else other than teach them the brain. And they were like, oh, well then if I do this, then this happens. You know what I mean? So over time, especially as they started experiencing successes, those hardest kids who had been, you know, suspended time and time and time again in previous years, and then we're finally able to make academic progress in my classroom. We're like, whoa, I thought it was just dumb. Like kids would say that. No, you can change your brain for the rest of your life. And teaching a kid that they can do that is one of the most empowering things I think you can do.
Well, that's great. So I know sort of the big thing even is just, you know, the breathing practice. But then there's more to it than that. Did you want to say much about like the breathing practice? Give just some little tips about that.
Sure. So as far as doing breathing practices in your classroom, you want to do it on a proactive basis, not just whenever everybody's upset. That's the only way to build a neural pathway in your brain to help, to help it actually have behavior change. You don't have behavior change without building new neural pathways in your brain. That's everything you do is a neural pathway. So tying your shoes is a neural pathway. Eating food or driving home from work is all a neural pathway that you can do almost automatically. And that's why you have to do this on a proactive basis so that whenever you do feel triggered, it becomes your fallback. It's just what you know. So doing it at least several times a day. I say the magic number is three for elementary kids. And I think for older kids, I think it's a good idea to transition in and out of the classroom. So if they passing time, so whenever they're getting ready to leave the classroom, I think a breathing practice when they arrive to their next classroom, that would be the appropriate time to do a breathing practice. And then whenever it's needed. And the thing is like you said, we were talking earlier, if you do those proactively, you will find less and less and less times that you get interrupted, less and less times that they can't get back on task after those interruptions. So it's not only the keeping everybody on task, but then when you do get diverted, I found that kids were able to get back on task faster. So the breathing practice, what I tell people is you breathe in like you're smelling something delicious. You breathe in your nose, and then you hold on to that breath because you're letting your body absorb as much oxygen as possible, and then you breathe out your mouth like you're blowing out a bubble. And when you do those things, it's scientifically, lots of science here about how the sensors in your lungs work and how your body knows that it's calm. So whenever you breathe out slowly, when that we have a longer out breath, you're actually telling your brain that everything's okay because you can't take long out breaths when you're running from a bear. So the first just breathe is our core practice with Be Mindful, and F stands for fist, meaning that whenever you get triggered, oftentimes you clench your fists. So that's just a normal automatic reaction. And so relaxing your hands, thinking about that, relaxing your jaw, because we often, the second thing we might do if we don't clench our hands, or we might do it in addition to, is clenching our jaw, and breathing. And I say, research says that 8 minutes a day of breathing is all it takes to transform your brain into what could be an amygdala heavy brain, where your amygdala works more than other people's brains. And stress can cause that over time. So if you work in a stressful environment, if you live in a stressful home life, or if you just have a lot of trauma from your past, you could have an enlarged amygdala. And that can cause you to feel like you get triggered real easy, or it also can trigger things like anxiety. So if you feel that way, it's very, very important that you do this more than 8 minutes a day, because it takes time to shrink that amygdala, which is what the breathing practice does over time. So that will create that space that allows you to have a moment of clarity before you make decisions based on what your amygdala is doing.
Great. Thank you. So I know we talked about the brain science and teaching kids that, and then the breathing. Are there any other tips that you have as far as, you know, things that you can do to help kids self-regulate?
Yes. Well, the two main reasons, the two methods of self-regulation, the two main ones in your body are breathing practices and exercise. So movement. So I think especially we do a great job in the elementary level understanding how much kids need to move. But I find as I visit middle schools, as I visit high schools, it becomes less and less important to teachers, but it's just as important to your brain. So I think it's really important that we, you know, make sure that we're including and incorporating movement, and not just that they get up and move in passing time, you know what I mean, for classes, but they get up and move, or that they do things in different ways that incorporate movement. That's super important, because that's the only other way to get cortisol out of your body. So if you're storing cortisol because of trauma or because of you know, negative experiences in your life, then you have to get it out, or it stays there. And that's what does the damage to your brain and body on the long term, especially with your health. So in thinking about that with teachers and the way that they need to take care of themselves, we are always going home with some stuff, right? And so this is where doing those breathing practices for yourself, even if you don't want to do it in your classroom, it is so, so, so important to do that for yourself. Not only taking care of yourself with your breath, that's the way to exercise and take care of your brain, but you also need to sleep enough. Teachers don't sleep enough. 47% of teachers sleep 6 or less hours a night. That's crazy. That's akin to having a drink and then heading to work. You can't drink at work. So you need to make sure you get enough sleep. Making sure that you're eating right, and it's not about, you know, dieting. It's about making sure that you eat the right things for your brain health. So making sure omega-3s, making sure that you're hydrating properly, because your body can't work right without the right amount of hydration. And teachers are known for skipping their water and drinking a little more Diet Coke to keep
probably because they're worried about when they're going to get that next restroom break.
I totally understand, but that's where we need to have a buddy system. I used to work that out with my buddy teacher, my next door neighbor teacher, and she would, you know, kind of watch our two classes while I would go to the restroom, and she would do, and then we'd switch. And we did that a couple times a day, just because we needed to supplement the times we could go to the restroom, because in elementary you don't have passing time.
Yeah.
And my lunch and my plan were butted up against each other, so it was just one break a day. So it was just a long break.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. So I think also for teachers, I think what's really important is making sure that you get downtime. That's one of the things that I find teachers don't get enough of as well, because that's the time that you can really reflect on your practice. And that's what being a great teacher is. So sitting on the couch, grading papers, watching TV, anything that you're double tasking, that's not downtime. So making sure that you give yourself enough downtime, making sure that you're social, not being a hermit. Teachers also are known for like being exhausted, and they make grand plans with other people and then they don't do it. They don't go out. They don't have fun on their breaks. They catch up on housework or grading or planning instead of going and having fun, because you know what? Those things are still going to be there, guys. Your to-do list never ends as a teacher. That's why I say it's not really a job. It's a lifestyle. So keeping in mind that in order for you to do your job to the best of your ability, you have to be a whole person. So you have to take care of yourself first in order to do all those things and absorb all that stuff that you have to do with the kids. So,
well, that is some great advice. And I encourage anyone out there who is looking for some great PD on this to get in touch with Michelle and bring her into your school. And as you heard, it'll then benefit another organization that can't afford to do that. So Michelle, the things that I learned from you over the summer and then again recently, I just really appreciate it. I know I tend to sit and eat at lunch at my desk because I know the kids are always going to be coming to the library to check out books, and you know, making it okay to take a little bit of time for myself during the day and think about, like, I control the emotions in my room, you know, and that if I'm keyed up all the time and not relaxed, then, you know, the kids are going to pick up on that. And, you know, that's something I need to think about. So thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it. So since this is part of my Gratitude 180 project, you know, I know gratitude is something that you practice a lot as well, as a way to kind of relive those positive feelings from the day and then, you know, pay it forward. Is there anyone that you would like to recognize right now, of somebody who's influenced your thinking?
Well, I would say I would definitely say our founder and our executive director, Anne Marie Rossi and Jason Dilch, they have changed my life in plucking me out of the teaching field and allowing me to not only work with teachers, but I work with first responders, I work with legislators, I work with all different fields, and now I feel like I'm able to impact at such a high level and with so many different people, and it just so fulfilling to be able to give people the gift of peace.
That's wonderful. And, you know, just listening to your voice, I feel calmer.
My kids say that. I still read to them and they're teenagers because they like listening to me read.
Yeah, that's good. I read aloud ends too soon, in my opinion.
Reading The Outliers. Great book. Anyway.
Okay. Well, thanks again, Michelle, for your time. I really appreciate it. And good luck to you in this new role that you have. It's definitely a loss to teaching, but as you said, now you're able to impact on a larger scale. So good work.
Thank you, Shannon. And thank you so much for bringing me in and really taking in what I had to say. I really appreciate that.
Terrific.